Well, you know, in biology, I'm a chemical prospector. I'm interested in finding new molecules because in the molecule there's interesting function, and this is the way I make my living in research. So we learned that many of the chemicals in insects that are interesting are chemicals that bugs use for defense. Bombardier beetle sprays at 100 degrees centigrade. And I was running out of obvious leads because there are insects that don't necessarily stink when you pick them up. They taste like hell, and you don't know that until you taste them. Well, I did a lot of bug tasting, but it turned out that some of the compounds that bugs use for defense against birds, for example, are not necessarily bad tasting to us. There's a group of insects called lysids, which are rejected by birds, and I've eaten them, and they taste like lettuce. So I had to find another criterion. And I asked myself, why not enlist the partnership of a bird? Feed it insects and keep track of what it likes. And that I did. I had a pet thrush, Swainson's thrush, called Fogel, which was very tame, had a big cage. And for one summer, I decided I'd systematically feed it on insects. It was a finicky gourmet. You could tell what it liked and what it didn't like. A bug that it liked, it would grab, and down the gullet it went. A bug that was of so-so quality would be picked up, dropped, and then either eaten or rejected, depending on how hungry the bird was. But there was a third category, which were the no-nos. Pecked once, rejected, remembered. You gave them the same bugs 2 weeks later, the bird would look at me and says, how dare you? Well, we fed about 500 items over the course of the summer. And we did this systematically. The whole family was helping. I'd go out early in the morning, collect the bugs, put them in individual vials, bring them back. Everybody would assemble for breakfast, including the bird in its little cage. And I'd give them one bug after the other. Score whether it's a yum-yum, a so-so, or a no-no. And by the end of the summer, I had these 500 items of about 100 species, and I classified them. And there were five in the no-no category, all beetles, including fireflies. I was interested in fireflies, and the fact that fireflies had a chemical hidden up their little sleeves was clearly not known. So I called a chemist I've been collaborating for 40 years, a very well-known chemist called Jerry Meinwald at Cornell. And I said, Jerry, how would you like to work on fireflies? They're terribly distasteful to birds. There must be something in there. He says, get me enough fireflies and we'll take a look. So I took an ad in the paper out. Wanted fireflies, 5 cents a piece. And I came to realize, we learn about the laws of supply and demand. I came to realize if you charge 5 cents a piece, if you give 5 cents for a firefly, the parents go out and collect and you can go broke in a weekend. We nearly went broke. The parents would come in with these jars full of fireflies. So we went down to a penny and got the kids in the neighborhood to help. Anyhow, we got enough fireflies. It turned out we didn't even have to get them in that way, because fireflies are collected and have their rear ends where the lantern is removed, because there are medical and biochemical reasons for getting at the enzyme substrate system in the lamp. And the front of the fireflies are thrown away. So we got a hold of the front of the fireflies, assuming that they taste as badly as the rear, and we had enough to do chemical work. And Jerry and his group identified a new category of chemicals, of the broader category known as steroids, which include estrogen, progesterone, testosterone, cholesterol, very familiar hormonal-like materials. And this was a new kind of steroid. Now, in chemistry, this is intrinsically very interesting because steroids always have interesting hidden functions. So Jerry was enthusiastic. The first thing we did, because these steroids looked a little bit like medicinal drugs that are taken for heart medicines, called, for example, digitalis, a very well-known cardiostimulant. So we thought we might have a bug with a drug, which in itself was a new expression. And we were quite enthusiastic because we had 20 years of collaboration where we never found anything of importance. We just informed things that were fun. And we sent out the chemical for testing, and it turned out to be a cardiotonic agent. So here was a firefly with a molecule of potential medicinal value. But it wasn't better than what was on the market, so we weren't going to replace anything. But our appetite had been whetted by then, and Jerry said, let's take a look at all the fireflies we can get a hold of to see whether they have variants of this molecule. We might come up with one which is, in fact, better what's on the market. Well, to make a long story short, We didn't. But here's the biological story that we did uncover. We found, first of all, that other fireflies either had these compounds or didn't. But the ones who didn't have them consistently. Early in the season, they would not have them. Later in the season, they would, but only the females had them in any kind of quantity. So there was something mysterious going on. And what's more, the chemical was the exact same one as the other species that we'd started working on. So there was no variability, disappointing from a medicinal point of view. But what was going on here about the compound sometimes being present in the other species? Now, I'd had a graduate student years ago called Jim Lloyd, whose PhD thesis was the deciphering of the communication code of fireflies. Fireflies communicate in lights. The ones that fly about at night are calling to their females. Different species, the males have different songs and lights. One of them might have da-dum, da-dum, da-dum. Another one might have da-dum, da-dum, da-dum. Now, it was known that the females of the different species answer their respective males. But the mystery was that the females of different species all answered with a single flash. So how did different males know that it was their own female was answering? And Jim found out something extremely interesting. The specific part of the communication code is the delay between the end of the song of the male and the answer of the female. It could be a half a second for one given species, and the female goes after half a second, boom. In another one, maybe, let's say, a third of a second, and the female goes boom. And that's how these songs and lights sort themselves out in the night. What Jim Lloyd also found is that there are certain fireflies, females, which he called firefly femme fatale, very appropriately, which do the following thing. When they want a mate, they wait for their own males to come by, and they answer with a delay that is species-specific for their own species. When they're hungry, they wait for a male of a different species to come by, and they fake the delay of that male's female, luring that male to what he expects to be a very different kind of reward. The female catches him and eats him and gets free steroids. That's why late in the season, some of the other species, the firefly femme fatale to be specific, were cropping up with the compound. They were getting it by stealth, by robbing it, and using it for their own particular purpose. Story doesn't end there. It turns out the female, after feeding on the male from the other species and getting the steroids, puts these steroids in the eggs, and that protects the eggs against egg eaters. So it's a mystery in the night, and boy, was it fun to work on.